of the world. I don't think any economist who would like to call himself economist, who would not like to be known otherwise, understood this. And everybody thought Modi had destroyed India, and some people told me Modi had decided not to get re-elected another time. This was the extent of not only misunderstanding, but total illiteracy about how this measure was not only necessary. Had this measure not been taken, economy would have collapsed in the next couple of years. I will just give you a few numbers which a chartered accountant ought to be familiar, but an audience like you who has invited a chartered accountant must also be forced to know some figures which are important to understand this. You know, if you look at which is the high growth period of Indian economy in statistics, in the eyes of the world, in the eyes of our own commentators and our own business people, stock market, they will say it is from 2004 to 2009. This is the period, maybe 11. This is the period in which the economy reached very high growth levels, and the average growth was almost 8.5%. And anyone would have, by looking at this statistic, said this is the best growth period of India in its entire history. But what everybody missed and everybody began to ask is, why this growth did not produce jobs at all? It is not that it did not produce adequate jobs. It did not produce jobs at all. Between 2004 and 2009, the total number of jobs added in the public sector, private sector, unorganized sector put together, including agriculture, is 27 lakhs, just 2.7 million in 5 years. This was the high growth period. But if you look at the previous 5 years of NDA from 1999 to 2004, in this period, the GDP growth was about 5.4%. It is not very high, it is not very low. And the jobs generated was 600 lakhs. 60 million was the jobs generated in this period. Why, with 5.4% average growth rate between 1999 and 2004, we could generate 60 million jobs, and with 8.5% growth rate over the next 5 years, we could generate only 2.7 million jobs. This question was asked, but nobody addressed with the real reason and logic and investigation as to why it did not happen, why we did not produce jobs. People simply said it was a jobless growth. But why the growth was jobless was not something which was investigated by anybody. That is where demonetization has emerged as the only answer which I am going to tell you. You know, if you look at 1999 to 2004, the average inflation was 4.5%. in that entire period. And so the commodity inflation was largely under control, less than 5%. But if you look at assets inflation, that was also under control. This is the single most important factor to be known as to what growth rates mean in totality. The asset inflation in that period, amazingly, the entire 5 year period saw the gold prices increase only by 38%. Stock market prices rose only by 32% in 5 years. And real estate prices rose from 21% to 31%. This was all the rise in asset prices in that period. But in the subsequent 5 years, of course, inflation was quite high. That was because of various reasons, including too much of money circulating, the cash money circulating, which I will come to later. But the most important fact is that the asset prices went up by 10 times in the next 5 years as compared to the previous 5 years. The stock market prices rose by 311%. Gold prices rose by 330%. And real estate prices rose from an average of 200% to 2000%. And money expansion was not much. If you look at the money expansion in the first 5 years, money expansion is one of the reasons for price rise, whether it is the commodity prices or asset prices. The money expansion was only about 17% more as compared to the previous 5 years. Where was this drive for higher asset prices come from? Was an investigation which was not undertaken, but it was happening right in front of the Prime Minister, Finance Minister, Reserve Bank, all economists, column writers. The entire secret was in the high denomination notes, the proportion of which increased exponentially. The 500 rupee notes and 1000 rupee notes, the total notes which were printed and circulated in 2004 was only 1.4 lakh crores. By 2015, this had gone up to 15.5 lakh crores. This was a 10 times multiple was the increase in the high denomination notes. In proportion, it went up from 34% to 87%. And the Reserve Bank of India, after this government came, the Reserve Bank of India was asked to give a picture of about how these 500 rupee notes and 1000 rupee notes operated in the economy. And the Reserve Bank headed by Mr. Raghuram Rajan gave a report that out of the 500 rupee notes and 1000 rupee notes, one third of the 500 rupee notes and two thirds of the 1000 rupee notes do not come back to the banking system after they are issued out of the banking system, which indicated some 5 to 6 lakh crores has been operating outside the banking system, and that is what caused the rise in the prices of stocks, gold and real estate. You know, there is a direct nexus between cash and gold, because much of the gold in India is bought and sold only in terms of cash. That is one of the reasons why the gold economy in India cannot be easily organized. Unless you make the original purchase of gold otherwise than by cash, all the subsequent transactions will also be only by cash. So this 330% increase in gold prices was entirely attributable to cash, and many people said gold is after all an international commodity, we don't produce gold, and so the world gold market decides the gold prices in India. It's absolute bunkum, because one third of the world gold imports is taking place by India. If the Indians have higher buying power of gold, that pushes up the world gold prices. It is the buyers who decide the gold prices and not the sellers. Because India and China put together buy almost 50% of world, 50-55% of world's gold. If these two countries somewhere can come together and cartelize the purchase of gold, the world gold prices will be in the hands of these two countries. That's a different issue altogether. But the fact is that the Indian buying power actually adds to the world gold prices. That's the first point to be noted. After demonetization, it is reversed. There is a 15% drop in world gold prices. Why? This first. Second, Dr. Swami has been talking about this participatory notes. You know, the amount of participatory notes, which is the money which the Indians smuggle away from India, put it in a foreign bank, and that comes as a regular investment because you align it with a regular foreign institutional investor's name. So your own black money goes out of India and comes back as investment, and he has been writing about it. Our M.R. Venkatesh has done quite a lot of work on this. So this money, which was just 64,000 crores in 2004, went up to 3.7 lakh crores by 2007. That was the reason for the rise in the stock market. Third piece of evidence. The real estate prices rose up by 200 to 300% in all cities, including a sedate place like Tamil Nadu. It's not a very vibrant real estate market. You know, Gurgaon, which was not in existence in 2001, 2002, recorded a 2000 percentage point increase in real estate prices. I will tell you about three deals in Bombay. The NTC property, which was sold in 2008, fetched in 2011 a 490% profit. It was all happening right in front. And these 500 rupee notes and 1000 rupee notes have been galloping. It's all available on computer. At no point did the Prime Minister Manmohan Singh or the Finance Minister, most part of it was P. Chidambaram, or the Reserve Bank said, why should we continue to issue these 500 rupee notes and 1000 rupee notes? We will give only 100 rupee notes if they are told the banking system. This kind of catastrophic increase, exponential increase, this explosive growth in the proportion of the 500 rupee notes and 1000 rupee notes, which completely finished the character and turned the economy from production to inflation, asset inflation, would not have taken place. This is where a man of great common sense, the Prime Minister of India, saw that unless this cash is attacked, there is no way this economy can be restructured and brought back to growth. This is a defattening of the Indian economy. Unless you withdraw this cash, many of the politicians, save a few exceptions, do not understand economics. You know, many people say black is not cash, black is gold, black is property, but they do not know. If the property value has gone up because of the cash component circulation, you withdraw the cash, the property prices will crash. You know, in Delhi, what is the position? One of my friends, Balbir Punj, he has been trying to buy a property for his daughter. He told me about a week back that previous to demonetization, they were asking 2 crores by check and 2 crores by cash. Now they are saying, please give me 3 crores all by check for the same property. You know what is the price of property in Botlem area? It was 14 crores a ground in October. Today it is 8 to 9 crores per ground. This is withdrawing the cash component of the market value of the property. So you cannot destroy the black economy without destroying the cash content of the economy. This is where the demonetization decision was one of the most economically rational and logical decisions, which could not have been thought of in any country other than India, because India functions not only on cash but also on relations. You withdrew cash, people turned to credit because they knew each other. The vegetable vendor knew, the buyers and sellers knew each other. So we could immediately shift to a relation-based trading model which sustained the economic activity. In no other country this would have happened. And see what happened after demonetization. People were standing in queue, kilometers of queue. Hours and days people stood in queue. And the opposition wanted the blood of the government. And they were baying for anarchy. And the Supreme Court said there will be anarchy. And the media said there is bound to be anarchy. 40 crore people stood in queue. No one protested. I don't think anyone could have given a much more reliable statement of trust in the government by any amount of writing, any amount of words, than 40 crore people standing in the queue as Narendra Modi wanted, wait for 50 days. The leadership that he provided in that 50-year period is unprecedented in the history of the world. In fact, many people would have been shaken in that period. But he said, wait for 50 days. The nation waited. And all the economists, some Paulson said, this is all completely rotten decision. And somebody said, it is looting the people. Somebody said, it is dictatorial. After the demonetization worked itself out, the chief economist of the European Union said, this is the most exemplary decision that has been taken in recent times. This is for, it is a lesson for other countries to follow. So I found one thing, the economists do not know economics. Otherwise, they would not have opposed it like that. Now the defattening has taken place, now what should be done? The money that was circulating outside the banking system has come into the banking system. Unless the banking system uses this money, the entire idea of demonetization will not only not succeed, but it has every reason to fail also. Why the banking system in India has been disabled like this? It is not because the banking system in India is inefficient. It is one of the most efficient banking systems. And our banking system has three firewalls as compared to the financial system of the world in terms of the non-convertibility of the Indian rupee. It's a very, very important firewall. Next, no foreign ownership of Indian banks. Next important firewall. Third important firewall is 75% of the banking assets are owned by the government of India. I don't think any other banking system in any part of the world has three powerful firewalls protecting the domestic finances from the global finances. If you want to understand the worth of it, in 1997, when the Asian crisis happened, there was a pressure on the Asian governments to open their banking and financial system to foreign investment. And no country accepted it except Korea. Malaysia said no, Indonesia said no, Thailand said no. But you know, Korea accepted because they were even more badly affected as compared to the other countries. Within 3 months of the opening of the banking system, four large Korean banks out of five became foreign owned. 80% of the banking assets became foreign owned. 60% of the Korean market capitalization became foreign owned. Today, Korea is not a financially independent economy. So Korea has to follow the same rules about whether something is an NPA or not, because its banking economy is fully integrated with the world economy. But our banking economy is not integrated, not integratable, and should not be integrated with the global financial system. But still we follow the same NPA rules. And how idiotic it is, I am going to explain to you with reference to only one industry. There are three industries which are suffering from NPA issues. Actually four, if you are textiles. One is steel, the other is power, third is coal, fourth is textiles. This accounts for 80 to 90% of the NPA in India. Last year the steel industry was NPA, because the steel industry itself was unviable. Today the steel industry is viable and making profits, but still the banks consider it as unviable because this is what the Basel norms say. The viability of the company is no issue. The industry has turned viable, it can pay money because you have taken measures by anti-dumping duty and others which makes the local steel industry profitable, and everybody is making tons of profit except one company in which there has been fraud. So what the banking system should do, Reserve Bank should do, government should do, political economic thinkers should do, is that in India you don't look into whether a debt is due for 90 days or not. Whether the debt will be realizable and the company is capable of paying the debt is the only test. You know why abroad they want these 90 days or 120 day test? Because for them liquidity is the most important thing. The banks will become illiquid if the money is not recovered in time. It is not a solvency issue. It is a liquidity issue. When the liquidity issue affected the entire world banking system in 2008, the US Federal Reserve System pumped in liquidity. They didn't pump in solvency, liquidity. So the entire banking norms outside India is to ensure that the market rated liquidity is the basis for the rules. In India, liquidity is not an issue at all. Why should we import the same rules and classify these loans as, and all these except steel industry, except textile industry, whether it is coal, or it is steel, or it is power, It is only because of the 2G and coal scam and the judgment of the Supreme Court and the way the UPA government messed up the whole thing. It is because of the government actions or inaction these NPAs were caused. So unless the government completely reframes the NPA rules and makes the viability of the industry or the concerned company as the only test, relieves the banking system of the Basel norms, 90 days and 120 days rule, the banks cannot start lending the money. If the banks do not lend the money, the Indian growth rate will never pick up. This is the biggest challenge before the government of India. And I am very happy there are some independent thinkers who think that the Indian finances, Indian banking system and the Indian regulation should also be different from how the world or the West or particularly the American mind thinks about regulating the finances. There is some independent financial thinking evolving in the country, though it's a very small group. And I am sure these NPA rules will be revised in the next couple of months or so, and the banks will start lending money. The moment the banks start lending the money, the economy picture will change. I will give you a small example as to what the banks do with the money that we deposit. You know, out of 17.5 lakh crores of currency, which is the primary money, the money that goes in and out of the banking system according to the Reserve Bank of India was only 10 to 11 lakh crores. This produced bank deposits of 96 lakh crores. That is how the bank multiplies the money. It is the bank which creates money and not the Reserve Bank of India, not the Bank of England, not the Federal Reserve System. It is because of this fractional reserve model the banks multiply the money. Now with this 10 lakh crores you have produced 96 lakh crores bank deposits. Another 5 lakh crores has come into the banking system. And this is capable of expanding into 40 to 50 lakh crores in the next 3 to 4 years. And maybe even 2 years if the banks start actively lending the money. That is why the Mudra plan, which is to address the smallest of production units of India, there are 58 million non-farming units employing 128 million people and needing a capital of 12 lakh crores has bank funds only to the extent of 4%. The Mudra plan is intended to advance this 96% loan which is due to them, which they are borrowing at 60%, 90%, 120%. This Mudra plan was thwarted by the Reserve Bank of India headed by Mr. Raghuram Rajan. Because this plan was not needed in America, and so he thought it is not needed in India also. You cannot think like an American and manage the Indian banking system. So a robust indigenous economic thinking is necessary. I would like Dr. Swami, of course, he has so many commitments in terms of Ayodhya, in terms of NDTV, in terms of Chidambaram, in terms of Sonia Gandhi. But I think like I have been forced to devote by accident a part of my time or a very significant part of my time for Tughlaq, I think you should devote some time for leading indigenized, domestically suitable economic thinking model for India. Why I said this is when he was working with Samuelson, I have heard people close to Dr. Samuelson's work saying that if only Dr. Swami had continued his work on the indexation system of India, he would have been one of the recipients of the Nobel Prize. So Dr. Swami's competence in the field of economics is very much needed for India. And I am willing to work with him. It's not that I am not willing to work in other areas. But there he may not need my help as much as he needs in this. So demonetization decision is a defattening of the Indian economy. It doesn't make the economy weak. It actually makes it strong. But the follow-up action in terms of two things. Activating the bank finances, bank lending, and instituting the mudra is the best way to see that India grows and grows really. You don't grow statistically. The statistical growth concept must be destroyed. The psychology focused on what is the growth should be tempered with what is the growth in employment. That is what we failed to do. I hope the Indian economic thinkers will come back to their senses and regard employment as the test. Thank you very much.